In this last video of the Fourier transform series, I'd like to talk about the fast Fourier transform, or the FFT. The FFT is actually an algorithm to compute the discrete Fourier transform in an efficient way. So it is not a different technique in terms of what we have as output, but instead another way to compute the Fourier transform, but instead of requiring a computational complexity of big O of n square, which is the complexity of the DFT. So imagine we have an image with 2 megapixels. What we are going to require to compute the DFT would be around 2 million pixels squared, which is a big number and would require a lot of time. So the FFT is another implementation of the Fourier transform that uses ideas from Gauss, from his work in the 1800s. But those ideas were used by Cooley and Tukey to build or to develop this FFT algorithm that was published in 1965. I'd like to talk a little bit about those two guys. So Cooley was a mathematician that worked with von Neumann at the University of Princeton and was a computer programmer and was a researcher at IBM until 1991. And after retiring, he took a position at as a professor at the University of Rhode Island. And John Tukey was chemistry, was a bachelor and master in chemistry, and did his PhD in mathematics, was a professor at the University of Princeton, and researcher at the AT&T Bell Labs. And he's also known for developing the box plot and also the post hoc test that's called nowadays Tukey HSD. So two very clever guys that made a significant contribution by publishing the fast Fourier transform algorithm. So instead of having a computational complexity of n squared, which is the original complexity of the DFT, the FFT allows us to compute the Fourier transform in n log n, which is much faster. There are several ways to implement this algorithm, and the original algorithm assumed that the n, the value of n, is a power of 2. So this is the original algorithm. But there are other implementations that does not require that, and we are not going to talk about that. I just want to explain the original algorithm that's easier to understand. So this algorithm, the Cooley and Tukey algorithm, uses what we call the successive duplication method. We are going to use a few assumptions in order to build this algorithm. So pay attention that the mathematics here can be a little, not complicated, I won't say complicated, but there are a few details that we want to keep in mind. So note that the DFT is actually a sequence of products and sums. So we are making a product here of this f of x and several complex exponentials and summing all of them. But note also that the term e to the power of minus j 2 pi is always the same. What changes here are the x's here and the u's here. Anything else stays the same. So what we have is a different powers of u divided by n times x. So this is what changes. The remaining, the other term is always the same. So we are going to use this property in order to rewrite this equation in this form here. So we are going to change the variable. Instead of using the complex exponential, I'm going to use a variable capital W, n. This n indicates the size of the transform or of the signal. So W of n would indicate that we actually want to write a complex exponential minus j 2 pi over n. Okay, so this requires us to include those two indexes here, u and x, to differentiate between the terms. Otherwise, we are going to have product with the same complex exponential all along this this sum. And let us consider the following properties: that there is a symmetry regarding the complex conjugate. What does that mean? It's because we have a complex number that when we have a complex number, a complex exponential such as this, we have a W variable in which W of n of u times n minus x is equal to W of minus ux. So this also requires, this is symmetric with respect to n here, which is actually the same as the complex conjugate that is indicated here by this asterisk of W ux n. So this will allows us to write this variable W, capital W, into this form here. So we know that W of u n n, so when we have this symmetry, because we have a symmetry here, so this n will divide one and by the other. So we are considering that x is equals to n, and then this will become 1. That's it. Also, we have periodicity in both x and u, which is given to us by the use of the sines and cosines that are underlying at this complex exponential here. So what does that mean? It means that if I sum some value n, so if I sum the same value with respect to the size of the transform, this is equal to the first evaluated signal, so the first evaluated point. So there is periodicity, and we consider that this periodicity happens over n in both x and u as well. So if we consider that, we can decimate the DFT. This means that we are going to obtain the complete DFT by using smaller parts. We are going to assume here, as I said before, that this n is a power of 2. Okay, so we are going to decompose f of x into indexes. And even indexes, that means all points that have even x's. So index for x equal to 2r, so any 2r. And odd indexes, that means 2r plus 1. So when r is equal to 0, equals 0. That means here that 2 times 0 is 0, and for this case, 0 plus 1 is 1. So when r is 1, then we have an even index of 2 and another odd index of 2 plus 1, 3. And that's how we compute those in terms of r here. So those are indices. Okay, so we have this term that is going to, because we have a sum, right? So we do not depend on the order of the sum. So we can first sum all the even indexes, and afterwards we can sum with the odd indexes, and then we are fine with that. And by writing this equation using even and odd indices, and by changing the variable to w, what we have is this equation here. So we explicitly split the function into two specific terms, two sums. Then we are going to make another step here in order to make those two sums more alike. What we are going to do here, because we have odd index, so it requires us to sum one here. So what we can do instead is decompose this. So we're going to distribute u, multiplying it by 2r, and then we are going to, let me just erase here. Yeah, so we're going to multiplicate u with 2r, and then this becomes this term here. And we're going to distribute u with 1, then it becomes un. But because wun is independent of the variable r, which is changing here, we can just take it out of the sum, then it appears here. So this term here, go, yeah, down here. All right, so with that, we can then finally rewrite it in terms of, instead of using actually r, because we are using, before we are using the variable r here, we can use instead, write it again in terms of x. Now what we have is basically two in an include here, so we have a term w2n power to the power of ux. So this makes it easier for us to work. And because there is periodicity also in the DFT, so we know that the DFT is periodic with respect to half the size of the Fourier transform. That means that when we compute some frequency u, this would be the same that the same as u plus n over 2. So we can write the transform as follows. So for the first half of the frequencies, we compute the transform by basically computing the transform for the even indices plus this term here that was taken out of the sum, plus the terms, the odd terms. And for the remaining of the this is n here, no, there is no over 2 here. So for the remaining frequencies from n over 2 to n, then we have, we may use this formula here. So actually what we have is this. So u minus n plus 2, u minus n plus 2. So we are getting it from something that was already computed. So basically what we're going to do is just to compute this, right? So you just want to compute this once, and then the other half, we are going to take it from the first one, because it is symmetric. And then, by using the relationship between the terms w, now we know that w2n equals to this complex exponential here, so we are just substituting this 2 here with this value here. This is the same as e to the power of minus j 4 pi over n, which is also the same of using e to the power of minus j 2 pi over 2 over n over 2. So this means that actually w of n 2n is actually equal to w of n over 2. then we can split the DFT into a sum of two DFTs with even and odd indices. And this is written here. So in practice, what we do in to implement that is just basically to implement this those two formulas here. So you're basically splitting it into parts of the of even and odd indices, and by doing that in a way, so we observe a repetition of the procedure, so we do it recursively for even and odd indices, and repeat the procedure for each half of the transform. We now have two parts of a quarter of the transform, the complete transform. So remember that we just need to compute half of it, half of this. So now if we split into even and odd, two parts, so we have two splits of n over 4. By repeating the procedure over and over, in the first step, so n over 2 will become 2 times n over 2 squared. And then repeating it over and over again, what we are going to have if we just follow this sequence of steps, so we have n over 2 and then n over 4, 8, so this is a power of 2. So every time we end up with a vector that decreases its size by a factor of 2. So that means that in the step p, what we have is n over 2 to the power of p, and then this leads us to a complexity of n plus n log of n.